Well, then let's pray, okay, before we go into a time of worship. Father, we just thank you for this wonderful, wonderful day, Lord God. We have so much to be grateful for and so much to praise you for, Lord God. And we thank you for the healing that has taken place, Lord God, in Little Hope. Lord God, that is so much of a miracle, Lord. But Lord God, there is others, Lord, that need your touch. So each one, each prayer request, Lord God, that was mentioned today, Father, whatever is spiritually, physically, mentally, whatever it is, Lord God, I would ask that you would touch them, Father. And whatever is taking place, Lord God, I thank you, Father, for bringing new people today. I thank you for our brothers and sisters that are here today for the first time, Lord. And I would ask, Lord God, that you would guide them, direct them, Lord God. Let them know that you care and love them, Father God, so much. Lord, we praise you for what's going on and praise you for this time that we can come together. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Stand.
I cannot fall, listening every moment to Thy Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all, standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. I come to You, let my heart be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in You. Lord, I come to know the weaknesses I see. Thank you. I want to know.
Mark asked me to pray for the offering this morning. I thought I'd share this little something with you. Scripture says, don't let your right hand know what your left hand's doing. There's probably a lot of analogies how you could apply that. So how would you apply it to tithes and offerings, which is what I'm up here for? Well, look at it this way. When a graduate goes up on stage to get his or her diploma, they do two things. They stick out their right hand, an offering of gratitude, of thanks, both from the chancellor or the principal to the person, the graduate. And the left hand then receives the diploma. Don't let your right hand know what your left hand's doing. Right hand says, I'm going to offer. But wait a minute, left hand, you haven't received anything yet. How can I offer unless I receive? That isn't how it works. Don't let your right hand know what your left hand's doing. Ask yourself this, who gave first? When did you ever receive? What about the things you have now? Where'd they come from? We have all received so much. Now we offer. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the many, many gifts that you've given us in our lifetime. The things that we have, the families we have, the friends we have. But more than all of this, our Lord and Savior, who came and gave it all for us. The first gift, the most important gift of all in our lives, the gift of salvation. As we come now to this time of worship, let us worship you freely in our giving. Let us extend that right hand of offering in response to the love and the suffering and the great gift that you've already given us. We thank you for this time together, this corporate worship time, that we look to each other in prayer and in offering and thanksgiving and love. So take this offering now as we gather it. Bless it in the way you can. Small, large, whatever, do your mighty work with it. And use us, Father, as your instruments of that offering, of that giving, as it reaches out to our neighborhoods, to our neighbors, to all parts of this world, that offering may go. We thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for using us. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning, saints of God. It's great to be in the house of the Lord, isn't it? And I have been blessed to just be with you today, to be a part of your praise and your prayer requests, your prayers, your singing. I love to hear you sing. So many places I go these days where people don't sing. They just kind of listen, but you sing, and it blessed my heart. And so it's really a joy to be with you. A few of you may be saying, well, who is that guy up there? My name is Rob Songer. I'm the district superintendent, and so it's my joy to be here today. Pastor Jason is away today. He's been leading you in this interim and doing a tremendous job. Amen. And so I have the joy of being able to step in his place today and be with you this day. Pastor Debbie would be here today, but she's recovering from a bit of eye surgery this week and is a little bit sensitive to light still. And so she's at home praying for you, asking me to tell you that she is lifting you in her prayers today. And so this morning, as we've come to this moment, we want to open our hearts to the word of the Lord. As you have been open to the Spirit of God, may you be open now to the word of the Lord. And so if you have your Bibles, let me invite you to turn to Romans chapter 8. And I'll begin reading at verse 28. I think it'll be up on the screen this morning, and you can follow along. And so I'll begin reading it at Romans 8, beginning at verse 28. And when I finish the reading of this passage of Scripture, I will say to you, this is the word of the Lord for the people of God. And I would invite you to then respond back, thanks be to God. This is the word of the Lord for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And so would you open your hearts and hear the word of the Lord this morning. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life again, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We're considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth or anything in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord for the people of God. Thanks be to God. This is truly one of the most powerful passages in all the New Testament. If you've been in the church for any length of time, you've heard it preached, and some of you have probably heard someone quote it from memory. The beauty of its language, the depth of its theology, they're just breathtaking to try to take it all in, what was spoken to us. But sometimes when we begin to look at the book of Romans as a whole, it just feels a little bit daunting to us, this amazing book that the Spirit has given us. But this morning, I want to just set the table for you that we might feast together on the word of the Lord. What we know is that the Apostle Paul, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, has given us this masterful, Spirit-anointed letter to what we believe were probably five house churches at that time. Remember, they didn't have buildings like this. They didn't have gathering places like we have. The church gathered in homes. And so we believe at this point there were five house churches in Rome. It was probably a total of about 100 people. And so Paul is writing a kind of pastoral letter that becomes this master class on the theology of how one moves and lives in a right relationship with God. And so this morning, if we had time to go through the whole of the book of Romans, we could kind of break it into two pieces. Romans 1 to 7 is what we believe. Romans 8 to 16 is then how we believe. 1 to 7, what we believe, our theology. 8 to 16, how then should we live if all of this is true? And so you get to chapter 8, and Paul is now saying, now that you know about the nature of sin and the way that I described it in those earlier chapters, now that you know about what God in Christ has done for us, now that you know about our struggle with the old nature, oh, the good that I would do, but I don't do that, the things that I don't want to do, these are the things that I end up doing. Oh, what a wretched person I am. Who will set me free from this body of sin and death? Now that you know about life in the Spirit, and Paul just has continually taken them and takes us to this high point where we can begin to catch a vision of what it means to be those redeemed people. What it means to be the redeemed, Spirit-empowered people of God. What it means to be the body of Christ. And so this morning, I want you to look at a picture that I have for you. You'll probably recognize this picture if we can find that picture. There it is. Y'all recognize that picture? Anybody recognize that? How many of you have stood in that spot? Most of you have stood in that spot. You've probably taken that picture. That is one of the most iconic pictures anywhere in the world, just beyond the tunnel as you look into Yosemite Valley. It's just this breathtaking photo. You look at it and you say, this is the glory of God. Creator God, you are magnificent. Look what you have done. Well, we need to understand that Romans 8 is that picture. Romans 8 is the picture of the glory of God in the people of God. It's the glory of what we've been invited into to live this life in the reality of the resurrection by the power of the Holy Spirit to become all that God has created us to be. And so it gives us this breathtaking view of God's love and His purpose for our lives. And so the passage begins here, verse 28. I think you'll be able to see it on the screen. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. What's that mean? All things just work out? All things? Come on, that's not the world that I'm living in. I'm living in a world where stuff doesn't just work out. Russia and Ukraine are not just going to work out. The economy is not just going to work out. All of the issues that we're facing in our world today are not just going to work out. Even the laws of physics, there is a law of entropy that says, unless there is a greater power driving things, everything moves towards decay. If you're not really clear about that, just get like a two-year-old toddler and put them in a room with all your fine china and all your fancy things that are kind of fragile, and you leave them alone for 30 minutes. You think that's just going to work out? It's not just gonna work out. And so it would seem that we're living in a world where everything is resisting God's good purposes. In fact, Paul even talks about that in the passage just before what we read. I think we're going to bring it up on the screen here for you. In verse 18, he talks about our present sufferings. We all suffer. That doesn't seem to be working out. In verse 19, we don't even know what we're supposed to be. It doesn't feel like it's going to work out. In verse 20, we live in a world where we are bound with frustration. Anybody know a little frustration in your life at any time? It doesn't feel like it's going to work out. In verse 21, our bodies are deteriorating and dying. It doesn't feel like it's going to work out. Verse 23, and so we groan and we wait. In verse 25, we then must have perseverance, and we don't want to have perseverance. We want it now. And in verse 26, we have all of this weakness in our bodies. And in verse 27, we don't even know how to pray as we ought. And so it seems that there would be all these things that would hinder God's purposes in our lives. But Paul reminds us that God is acting on our behalf because of his great love. Because of God's love. There are all these things that seem to frustrate God's purposes, but God in Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, says, hold on, don't lose hope. I am for you. That's the good news that you need to hear this morning, saints of God. God is for you. He is on your side. He is with us. And so it's important for us to begin to think that through, because you might say, well, Pastor Rob, how does that work? Explain that to us. Well, it is a mystery, but we see God at work. Several months ago, Pastor Debbie and I had a flight cross country to a conference that we'd been at, and so we're on our way home. We'd booked our tickets months before, had all of our seats together like we always do, and so we get to the airport, we check our luggage, and they hand us new boarding passes, and we are assigned middle seats opposite side of the aisle. And so I immediately stepped back up to the young lady behind the counter, and I said, oh, ma'am, there's been a mistake. There's been a mistake. We booked our seats, and we're together. This is not right. And she said, I'm sorry. There probably has been a mix-up. The flight is completely filled. There's nothing I can do. She turns away, and I said, ma'am, turn back. Look at me. Look at me. Do I look like a middle seat guy? I am not a middle seat guy. There has been a mistake. You need to help me. You need to change this. She said, I'm sorry, sir. There is nothing I can do. And so I ended up in the middle seat next to Russ at the window. Russ is a big guy. I'm a big guy. And so here we are kind of crunched together. And I'm just thinking, Lord have mercy. This is not working out. But God was at work. And so I said hello, and Russ said hello, and we just started having this conversation, and I began to ask him about his story, and he began to tell me who he was. You see, Russ is a regional representative for this large pharmaceutical company, and his division focuses primarily on chemotherapy drugs, and he travels all over the world, and he makes a lot of money, and he had all the toys and all the stuff. He's an avid hunter. He's an avid fisherman, a semi-pro water skier, and Russ has Parkinson's disease. I saw it in his hands before he told me the story. And Russ was really nervous that day. And about 3 weeks after that, he was facing a surgery where they were going to be putting electrical implants into his brain to try to give him the opportunity to control the tremors that were destroying his life. And so we just kept talking and having this conversation, sharing our stories with one another. And eventually it came around to kind of talking a little bit about faith. And so he told me that he'd grown up in the Catholic Church. His whole family was Catholic. And he'd been very involved in the church when he was a kid. But when he got out of high school, he said, I'm done. I don't want anything to do with that. And so he kind of believed in God, but he didn't want anything to do with the church. And so he asked me, so what do you do? Love that question. And so I said, well, I'm a pastor, but actually I'm a district superintendent. And he said, well, what's that mean? And so I tried to tell him what I do. And he said, well, you didn't sign up for that, did you? Surely you didn't sign up to be one of those. And we talked about that a little bit more. And we just kept talking about faith. And he said, can I ask you a question? So what makes your church any different from the church that I grew up in? And I began to tell him about my dad. My dad, who'd grown up in this alcoholic home, who had been incredibly abused in ways I can't even begin to tell you about, who had been finally abandoned by his alcoholic dad, and my grandmother and these three little children found their way into this little Nazarene church. But it was in that little Nazarene church, it wasn't that they found the church, they found Jesus. They found Jesus. And it changed the whole direction of my dad's life. It turned him around. It saved him. And I began to tell him about my dad and how my dad met my mom and how that changed the direction of my life and finding this personal relationship with Jesus. And Russ said, that's amazing. I've never heard a story like that. We talked for 2 hours and we're about to land. And I said, Russ, I know I've just met you. I also know that you're pretty anxious about this surgery. Would it be all right if I just prayed with you today? He said, I'd really like that. And so Big Russ next to the window and Big Rob in the middle, we just take hands and we just start praying and ask Jesus to be with him, ask Jesus to love him, to remind him how much he's loved, that Jesus would be with him in his surgery, and we just prayed it down. And God was with us. Can you explain that to me? Do you think God just changed our seats? See, I don't understand all the mysteries of all of that, but I know that God is working. I know Russ needed somebody to sit next to him, and God knew I'm pretty impatient in a lot of things. And he just thought you could benefit from, I don't know how God works that out, but Paul wants us to know that God is working in all things for those who love him. And that's where it's most clearly seen, is in those who love him, who are called according to his purpose, not in some transactional sense where if you do something good for God, he'll do something good for you. It's not like that. It's not that our love initiates God's action, but that God's love is working out God's purposes in our lives. So here's the big question for this morning. So what is God's purpose for us? If you could just go home with that, that'd be a pretty good thing if you knew what God's purpose is for you. And so I need to give you a really big word that you can take home today. You can say, I learned a really big word today. And so God's great purpose for us is our Christoformity. Would you say that word with me? Christoformity. You say, Pastor Rob, what's that mean? It means to be formed in the likeness of Christ. Just what you would think, Christoformity, your Christoformity is God's desire, God's will that you should be formed in the likeness of Christ. Well, why, you might say, well, why is that such a big deal? You see, when you think about Jesus, whenever you think about Jesus, wherever he was at, there was always this sense of God's blessing and God's restoring work in the world. He was healing people, blessing people. There was always this intersection of blessing and restoration. The more we are formed in the likeness of Christ, the more our Christoformity takes place, the more we find ourselves living in this intersection of blessing and restoration. And that's what the world needs. The world needs to find someone meeting them in the intersection where blessing and restoration can take place. I want you to look at this next picture here. This will help you, I think. This is sin. This is what sin does. It burns everything to the ground. Whether you are single, married, young, old, rich, poor, sin burns everything to the ground. But the good news is, sin doesn't get the last word. The devil doesn't get the last word. Let me show you what God is up to in this next picture. This is God's will for your life. That God replants, and God restores, and God forms, and God heals. That's what he wants for us. So throughout Romans 8, we keep hearing this story of sanctification and holiness. And I think a lot of times in the church, we hear those words like sanctification and holiness, and we think, well, God's just trying to make me a religious robot. That's what God's trying to do. That's what sanctification and holiness is. It's God's replanting. It's God's reforming. It's God's healing. It's God's blessing so that we can flourish in this world, so that we can flourish in our lives. And so that's a pretty exciting thing to begin to think about, this sense of flourishing that we were created for. Let me come at it like this. Do you remember what was going on where you were at on Saturday, October the 15th, 1988? Saturday, October the 15th, 1988. Do you remember what was happening that day? It was first game of the World Series. The Dodgers were playing. It was the bottom of the ninth inning, and the Dodgers were losing. There was their great slugger, Kirk Gibson, who was in the dugout because he was injured. Both legs were injured, and they were in trouble of losing the first game and probably losing the series. And Tommy Lasorda, the coach, makes this strange decision. He says, Kirk, go get a bat and go to the plate. The old man with two injured legs. What a bad decision. But somewhere between the dugout and the plate, the old man with injured legs summoned something beyond himself. Something happened in him that in that moment, he became fully alive in the baseball sense. Became fully alive to achieve all that he could be. And if you know anything of baseball history, the old man with the injured leg stepped to the plate and hit a two-run home run, and they won the game and go on to win the World Series, one of the greatest moments in sports history. This is not about baseball or Kirk Gibson or home runs or anything. This is about flourishing. And that God doesn't design you to just flourish one time swinging a bat. He wants you to flourish Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, from morning till night, to be all that you were created to be. That's God's great design, because God is for us. Well, now then the passage gets really exciting, because Paul wants us to know how committed God is to your restoration, to your replanting, to your healing, to your blessing, to your flourishing. And so we read these words in verse 29 and 30. Follow along. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, thinking about Christiformity, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he called. And those he called, he justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. Now this is really powerful. But to really grasp it, we have to slow down just a little bit and do a little bit of theology this morning. Is it okay if we just kind of convene theology 101? Okay, we'll just do that for a few minutes here to help you to grasp the significance that God is for us. You see, so often when we get to verses 29 and 30, we either assume that these are something to win a theological argument, or we just kind of go quickly around them because we're not quite sure what to do with them. But I want us to just lean into them a little bit. And so I'm going to give you just a little bit of theology lesson that you can go home and say, man, we did some good theology in church today. So for centuries and centuries, there have been two prominent streams of theological thought that kind of flow out of what Paul was teaching. Way back about 300 years after Christ, there was a guy named Augustine. And Augustine began to say, well, we all believe in God. And so the best way that we could know God, perhaps God's primary trait would be God's sovereignty. If we think about that, that God is God, God chooses, God decides, God is sovereign. We all believe that. Well, there were a lot of other people along about the same time, one guy named Pelagius, that said, well, you know, we do believe that God is sovereign. But what we also believe is that perhaps his primary trait is holy love. And that's how we know God best, that we know his sovereignty in light of his holy love. And so God is love, and that holy love does not coerce, and it gives us free will. So you have these two streams of theological thought, God's sovereignty and God's holy love. So then more than 1,000 years pass. And we come to this next slide where there's this guy named John Calvin. And John Calvin says, we believe that the sovereignty of God is God's primary trait. And that when you begin to think about the story of humankind, that story really begins in Genesis 3, the fall. That man sinned. In fact, an awful lot of the evangelism tracts that you would read, where do they begin? For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. They start with sin and the fall. And in the fall, then, in this line of theology, the image of God in humankind is completely destroyed. The image of God is obliterated. But along about the same time, there are a lot of folks, Jacob Arminius was one of them, that said, well, but holy love, we believe that holy love is the primary attribute of God. And so then our story really begins in Genesis 2, in God's good creation, that you were created in the image of God. Amen? Okay, about 7 people were really convinced about that. Let me try it again. You were created in the image of God. Amen? We believe this in the good image of a good God. And so God created us. And when sin came into the world, it's true that his image was twisted and scarred, but not destroyed. It was twisted and scarred, but no matter who you see, no matter how far from God, the image of God is still within them. That possibility of becoming like Christ is still within them. And so then what begins to happen if you follow the line of Calvin as you begin to think about all of that, then we have a decision that we have to begin to think through. Do we believe that the image of God was destroyed in us, or that it was scarred but can be restored? These two lines of theology have been continuing for a very long time, since the time of Christ. So in Calvin's order, if you begin to think about it, then you begin to have this idea of total depravity, that we're totally depraved, we're hopeless. And so then among our Reformed Calvinistic brothers and sisters, what you find, I think you'll see it on this next slide, what you then see is like unconditional election. You're elected, you're not. You're in, you're not. And so then there's limited atonement, that because you've been elected, then the grace, the atoning blood of Jesus Christ is good for you, but not for you. Good for you, but not for you. And the grace of God is irresistible. If God has elected you, you cannot say no. But then for Jacob Arminius and those that followed in this Wesleyan Arminian holiness, what we now know as the Nazarene way, we begin to think about the holy love of God. We've been broken by sin, but not destroyed. And so then there is then this, in the next slide, you'll see there is this preceding, prevenient grace, the grace that has gone ahead of us since before time. And so then we have free will, but God enables us with enabling grace. And then there is saving grace, where God desires that none would be lost. And then sanctifying grace, where the power of God makes it possible for us to move towards restoration. This conversation is still going on today. You know, in churches that are more Reformed and churches that are more Wesleyan, Arminian, this conversation still goes on. Everybody loves Jesus. Everybody wants to be like Jesus. And someday we're all going to get to heaven, and all my Reformed Baptist sisters and brothers are going to come up and say, Pastor Rob, you were right, we were wrong. Or maybe we're all just going to get to heaven and fall at the feet of Jesus and say, thank you for loving me. Thank you for loving me so wonderfully in ways that I can't even begin to comprehend. But you see, for us to begin to think of what this really means for us is absolutely powerful. Our theological understanding of God's holy love, that in his holiness, he is seeking to restore what has been twisted, to restore what has been damaged. And so by God's good grace being poured out before time began, that grace goes ahead of us and it enables us and it can save us and it can sanctify us, that we can achieve this sense of Christoformity, being conformed, being shaped in the likeness of Christ, because God is for us. And so that's a really good point to stop. We could just stop, say amen, and go home, but there's just some other really good jewels that I want to give you quickly this morning. See, how do we understand these big words like foreknowledge, predestination, election? Those are words that we kind of stumble over sometimes. And so let me just help you just a little bit very quickly. Foreknowledge, what does that mean? God foreloved us, forechose us in Christ. God loved everyone before the creation of the world. He loved all of us, and he is doing everything he can by whatever means he can that everyone can be loved. Divine foreknowledge doesn't mean that history is written and that you don't have any choice. Divine foreknowledge means that God is working all things so that everybody can have an opportunity to be formed and transformed into the image of God. So then predestination is really simple. Predestination is God's predetermined action on your behalf. That he has predetermined that he would act so that everyone would have an opportunity to choose life in Christ, to be formed in Christ's likeness. Predestined means marked out. That's all it means. Marked out, a predetermined purpose that God had decided in advance that his purpose was for you to be formed in the likeness of Christ, to be replanted, to be restored, to be blessed, that you might flourish in the image of God, that you could be all that you were created to be. See, for us, we need to understand that it doesn't convey this sense that God is making you do something. God has given you free will, but his purpose is that we might be transformed by God's love. And so Paul's understanding of predestination was that God had made the decision to initiate his love before time began, and he made the decision to be faithful to you when you were unfaithful. He made the decision to offer you forgiveness when you were unrepentant. He made the decision to justify you when you were still ungodly. He made the decision to sanctify you when you were still unholy. And it was God's purpose, God's decision, that all people could have that opportunity. In 2 Peter 3:9, look at what the scripture says. We know that the Lord is patient, not wanting anyone to perish, but that everyone could come to repentance. John 3:17, God didn't send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Election, it just means calling. It's an invitation, not an ultimatum. It's God's initiation, but he doesn't make anyone do anything. It's a plan. It's not a script. God plans. He desires that someday you would be glorified. We have prayed for your mom that one of these days soon she will be glorified. We pray for that day. What will that be like? You think about Jesus after the resurrection. Jesus in his resurrected body, he can sit on the beach and taste the fish that he eats with his disciples. He can feel the sun on his face. He can hug the little children. He is touched by doubting Thomas. He can step through walls where the doors are locked. He can disappear from rooms when eyes have been opened. He is in this glorified state. Well, the Apostle Paul wants us to understand That's the fulfillment someday, but I'm already starting now. That process of glorification, it's not just, well, hang on and die, and then God will get you out of here to the good stuff. The good stuff has already begun. Being in church with you today is the good stuff. Hearing your praises and your prayer requests is the good stuff. Hearing how God is at work is the good stuff. And God is moving in this powerful, powerful way. Paul wants us to know the invitation is there for you to move into this sense of flourishing in the world now. Years and years ago, Debbie and I moved to Los Angeles to pastor church there. And when we arrived in this church, there was a family in the church. He was the president of the Nazarene Credit Union. It was a big organization and so great family. And they used to do this thing where they had this big dinner once a year for members. And so they'd have 1,000 people that would come to this huge members dinner. They'd have these great speakers and they'd do all these really cool things. Well, Debbie and I were members, but we'd never gone because we were only $25 members. That was like the minimum amount that you could have in the credit union to be members. And so we were $25 members. Well, the president says, hey, Pastor Rob and Debbie, I want you to come and come to the dinner. So, okay. So the night came and we go to the dinner and this place is just gorgeous. And there are just hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people, this huge crowd. And so they're all dressed in their finest and we're dressed in the best that we've got. And we come in and this young woman comes up to us and says, oh, Pastor Rob, Debbie, so good to have you here. Come with me. And so we start following her and we start walking towards the front and I'm getting kind of nervous. And so we just keep walking past all the other tables and we walk right to the very front. And there's the brand new president of Point Loma Nazarene University, Dr. Brower, and his wife Linda seated at that table. And the lady takes us up and says, you're right here next to the president. I said, oh ma'am, there's been a mistake. We're not supposed to be here. There were these other important people that were having a seat as well. I said, we're not supposed to. She says, yes, this is your seat. Look at, those are your names. Pastor Rob, Debbie, you're right here. I said, no, ma'am, we're not supposed to be here. We're only $25 members. We should be like in the lobby. Or at least in the way back. We don't. She said, you don't understand. It's not who you are. It's not what you know. It's who knows you. And the one who knows you has invited you to sit here. See, that's the way it is with Christ. It's not what I know. It's not who I am. It's who knows me. Jesus knows me. And he has invited me to sit at the front table. See, there's not a one of you here that God has said, well, you know, I got a place for you out there in the lobby. Just inside the door, I got a place for you. He is inviting you to the front table of life for blessing and healing and restoring for your transformation that we can be all that Christ created us to be. And so the passage that we just went into, it kind of finishes up in this way. So if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, give us all things? Who will bring charge against those whom God has chosen? It's God who justifies. Who can condemn? No one. So then in verses 35, Paul begins to list some things. Well, but what about? Are there some things that could kind of get in the way? And he says, shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? Those are all things that Paul had faced or was going to face. He died by being beheaded by the sword. These were all things that he'd faced. And no, none of them can stop the love of God. God is for us. Do you ever... Do you ever have the fear that someday God just might get tired of you? Say, I'm tired of your mess ups. I'm tired of your failures. I'm tired of all the promises you've made and the promises broken. I'm tired of you. I'm done with you. I think for me growing up in the church, I had those fears. I think that's a part of the reason when I was a kid, I went to the altar like 1,000 times. Anybody go to the altar 1,000 times? Because I was afraid that there would be a day when God would just finally say, I'm done with you. I am tired of you. And I'd have to confess that even now, there are those moments where someone is whispering in my ear, the evil one is whispering in my ear, you're not worthy. You're not worth it. You're not good enough. You're a fake. You're a fraud. You're a failure. And then I hear the words of the apostle saying, no, no, I'm not. No, I'm not. In all these things, I am more than a conqueror. We are more than conquerors through Jesus who loved us. For I'm convinced that not death or life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, not any power, not height nor depth, or anything in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. God is for us. Amen? He is for us. And so this morning, I want to pray that prayer of blessing over you. You may have come here today feeling defeated. You may come here today feeling discouraged. You may have come here feeling like you are a failure, like you are a fraud. God is for us. He is for you. He is for your blessing. And so this morning, if you would desire to just feel that sense of God's approval of you, His love for you, His blessing for you, could I just invite you to just put out your hands where you could just feel the weight of that blessing and receive these words today. May the Lord bless you and keep you. And may even this morning you know that the face of God is shining upon you, that He loves you more deeply than you could ever know, and that He wants to bless you, that He wants to heal you, that He wants to restore you so that you can live in the intersection of blessing and restoration, so that you can be a blessing in this world. And so we ask all of these things in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now I must say to you, the service is not dismissed, but you are sent in the name of the one who is for you. Amen. Have a great day and have a great week. God is for us. Amen.